Hello, my name is Catherine Gary. Some of you may know me as the editor of the Freedom Press, which is a publication that I put out quarterly in Hempstead, dealing with issues in the community of Hempstead, essentially racial issues, and black history, trying to bring forth into the community a lot of history that is left out of the history books in the schools. And as we grow up, we don't really give enough attention to the real history of the black community and of America. And so we try to bring out information along those lines. But in terms of the current day and the situation in Hempstead, I have been following the various proposals over the years to do a revitalization of the downtown area. And I believe that most people would like to see some type of revitalization. However, the proposal that is currently being considered is quite drastic, and a lot of the information about it has just not come out to the people so that people can have a real understanding of exactly what they are trying to do. The history of this goes back about 7 years when Urban America was brought into the community by Mayor Hall after his election for his first term. And Urban America proposed a plan with tall buildings and urban urbanscapes that the people in the community rejected. And at that time, and I believe it was 2007, the mayor, who was pushing this initially, came forth and said that he was withdrawing this plan for various reasons. He was listening to the people's voice who were rejecting it, and he also felt that it was going to actually increase taxes rather than decrease them. So this was a major step. People issued a sigh of relief. Unfortunately, though, they persisted in determining and developing what was called a master plan. And that master plan was also opposed at public hearings by a lot of people in the community, because again, it was calling for 10 and 12 story buildings in the community. It was looking for higher densities, and there was a lot of controversy over that. And the people opposed it, but unfortunately at that point, and I believe that was in 2009, the village board voted for the downtown master plan. And I raise this because this plan by Renaissance Downtown Urban America, which we will just call the developer at this point, is an incorporation of the principles that are in that master plan. And that is the part of this that is very distressing, because the people opposed a lot of the items in that master plan, specifically in terms of the height of the buildings and the increased densities. So what I want to convey here is that this all came to a head when Urban America gets reintroduced with a new company called Renaissance Downtown. They join together, and they basically are proposing the same thing that Urban America was proposing initially, which was rejected. But they're doing it in a more so-called diplomatic fashion. They're going around talking to people, trying to get them on their side. However, my position is that they are not telling the people the truth about what they are actually trying to do here. It all came to a head on February 7th of this year, when a public hearing was scheduled at a special meeting of the village board. A special meeting is one that is called mostly on an emergency level, when this was not really an emergency. And the people don't know the meeting has been scheduled, because it's not a regularly scheduled meeting. And so they have their meeting, and at that meeting, which was held on January 27th, they decided to schedule a public hearing on the downtown, the sale of the land in the downtown to the developer. The public did not really know about the hearing because there was hardly anybody at the hearing, at the scheduled meeting to even know about it. I just happened to see it in the legal notice in the local paper, The Beacon, and I was quite shocked to see that because I would have thought people would have known about it and I would have known it without having read about it in the newspaper. It seemed that the word had not gone out to the community, and I took it upon myself to get the word out, myself and a few other people. We put out like 1,200 flyers to let people know about the public hearing. And the flyers drew quite a large response. There were over 200 people that came out, and most of the people that were coming in opposition to this proposal to sell all the village land to the developer were not allowed into the room because the room could only just take, I think, like 84 people or whatever. And so people were held outside the public hearing. Not only that, the actual purpose of the public hearing was withheld from the people. And I believe it was purposely withheld from the people. Because this public hearing was an extremely crucial public hearing. What it involved, it was a hearing on the sale of all village land in the downtown area to this one developer. Not only the village land, but the land owned by the Community Development Agency, the CDA. And just to give you an idea of the size of the area, if you can kind of see this, it goes from Garden City up here to almost down to Harriman Avenue, quite a bit south of Peninsula Boulevard, and all the way over to where Peninsula comes around and hits Fulton, and then over here, I believe that's Cathedral Avenue over on this side. So it's quite a large area. And there's a lot of village-owned property in this area. But what happened in terms of the public hearing, I think I was probably the only one there at the public hearing who had read the 45-page document that this hearing was to be considered. The village presented it as a master developer agreement, when in fact it was a land disposition agreement or a land acquisition agreement, land disposition in that the village was disposing of its land, and land acquisition in that developer was acquiring all this land. Now, at a usual public hearing, what happens is the mayor asks the clerk to read the public notice. And so that happened, and the clerk read the public notice. However, the public notice that she read was not the public notice that was given in the newspaper. It specifically omitted the actual purpose of the public hearing, which was to sell the village land without sealed bids to the developer and the CDA land as well. So that part was left out so that people attending the meeting did not know that the purpose of the meeting was this land sale, this massive land sale. After the public notice, or half of the public notice was read, usually the mayor then goes to the village attorney and says, "Will you please explain to the public what this is about?" He did not do that. He did not ask for an explanation from the attorney. Instead, he gave quite a lengthy attack on people who in the community or from without the community were in opposition to this plan that had been proposed by Urban America. So again, he did not use that opportunity to tell the people that this public hearing, the whole purpose of the public hearing, was to decide on the sale of all this land to the developer. After he spoke, then the developer spoke. He went on a lengthy speech, but he did not, in the same way the mayor did, they neither one of them explained to the public that this particular public hearing was for the express purpose of talking about the sale of all village property and all CDA property to the developer. One speaker after another got up without knowing what the intent of this meeting was, and I really have to stress here that the public notice indicated that this meeting was called under section 507(2)(d) of Article 15 of General Municipal Law, which has to do with urban renewal areas, and that particular section, 507(2)(d), has to do with the sale of village land without sealed bids. That was never told to the people. Since the mayor and the developer centered their remarks on things like jobs and community benefit agreements and things like that, most people assumed that that was the purpose of the meeting. And one speaker or another talked about the need for jobs and how they were going to see that jobs would be included in this proposal. About halfway through, I was able to speak myself. And I brought to the attention of the people and the board that this agreement, which I had read, indicated that the village was going to sell all of its property, including the property that we were standing on or sitting on at that time, right in Village Hall, the Village Hall property, the land that was that the library was on, the parking lots, the building department, the police department, the parking lots behind the library, all of that land, including all other land in the village, was to be sold to this developer. I also stated that not only is this agreement for the sale of all this village and CDA land, it also indicated that developer was going to buy up all the county land in the village, which meant the courthouse, which meant there's a building they have up on Main Street that had been a medical building. It meant the bus terminal, which is owned by the county. That not only the county land, but all the town land in the community was to be sold. And that would include Town Hall. It would include the building on North Franklin that you can pay your taxes, your town taxes at. And it included all the parking lots in the entire community. I waited for them, for the mayor and for Commissioner Gooding to acknowledge that what I had said was correct. And I paused and I waited and they said nothing. I thought perhaps they would deny it. They didn't deny it, but they didn't acknowledge it either. And I was made to look like maybe I didn't know what I was talking about. Fact of the matter is I did know what I was talking about. This whole document, 45 pages, is a document for the sale of that land, the village land, the CDA land, and for an agreement of the village to help the developer buy the county land and the town land and any other governmental property, including the Prospect School, which is also in the area. In addition, that document called for them to assist, called for the village to assist the developer in buying up all the other privately owned land in the community. Now, if you look at the document, and again remind you that when I said all these things, nobody on the village board, none of the attorneys, none of the people on the CDA who were sitting there, not the commissioner of the CDA, acknowledged that what I said was correct. The document itself, like 10 to 12 stories in a circle with the railroad station at the center, which would have a radius of a quarter mile. They would allow for 10 to 12 buildings there. And then in another circle beyond that, with a radius of a half a mile, which would have a diameter of a full mile, the buildings go up to 85 feet, which is like about eight stories. But in the overlay district, they get incentives to build higher than that. That's built into this overlay district thing. And this information, see, is not in this particular document. They just use the word overlay district. And how do I know what the overlay district is? Because I'm familiar with the comprehensive master plan. That plan is what talks about the overlay district. And if you read this particular document, it says that the whole purpose of this is to implement what's in that comprehensive master plan, where they list what the overlay district is with these 10 and 12 story buildings with incentives to build higher. And that is very significant, that they are getting incentives to build higher. What the process of determining the purchase price was going to be. It's quite an involved process where they either agree on one appraiser, all the parties like the CDA, the village, and the developer, they all agree on one appraiser and they can go with that appraiser, but if they don't want to do that, they can each have their own appraiser, and then if they can't agree, they'll get a third appraiser and have all kinds of ways that they're going to figure out what the purchase price is going to be on this land. But that's not the only, it goes on, this whole document, it goes on for all types of conditions and agreements for 45 pages of this land sale that the village is agreeing to. And as I said, they're agreeing to assist the developer to buy the town property, the county property, any other governmental property, and perhaps even the Long Island Railroad Station, as well as all the, they agreed to help them to create alliances and other agreements with the property owners of the privately owned property, which is going to include the churches, incidentally, also. So the village, by signing this, has agreed to help them. And as I go further, you will see that it's very likely that the threat of eminent domain is going to be utilized here, because they constantly say they're not going to use, like the developer would say he's not going to use eminent domain. Well, a developer never uses eminent domain. It's a village that uses eminent domain. So a developer can say that as much as he wants, but the agreement says that the village is going to help him to get this land. And how can the village help him? Under the threat of eminent domain. It's very obvious. So let's go back to the sale of the village land and the CDA land, because it says here that if they're going to sell all the properties as specified on Exhibit B. So if you go then to Exhibit B, and you see where it says Village properties, legal description. It says all village property within the project area other than roads and utility infrastructure. Then it says the parties will more specifically identify these village properties by their section, block, and lot within 90 days of the execution date. The same thing happens when it talks about the CDA properties. It says all CDA properties within the project area other than roads and utility infrastructure, and that the parties will more specifically identify the CDA properties by their section, block, and lot within 90 days of the execution date of this agreement. Now, the execution date of this agreement was February 9th because they had a resolution to adopt it on February 7th, but they signed it on February 9th. The thing is that the village and all of the village trustees voted for this, all of them, and the mayor. They signed a document with blank pages here because it says that this information will be given in 90 days. Now, how do you sign a document for the sale of land when they're going to tell you what the land is in 90 days? This is like beyond comprehension. Did the village attorneys look at this document? Did the village attorneys advise them that this was an okay document to sign? Did the CDA attorneys look at this and advise this? Did Mr. Kirkpatrick, who's the village consultant on this this plan, did he write this? Who wrote this? Someone has to find out who wrote this and who said that this was an okay document to sign. This is disgraceful. No one in his right mind would sign a document for the sale of land when they don't put down what the sale of the land is. Of course, they do say it's all village property. That's clear. It says all village property. So they knew that much, that they were talking about all village property. So they did not give the section, blocks, and lots. So 90 days passes, and I request the list of the documents that of the village properties that are going to be sold. And I was given the list. It's called Exhibit B. And that's the list of the village properties. That's just page one. Mm-hmm. You see the section, block, and lot of all these properties. Then there's page two of the village properties. Then there's the CDA properties, right? They don't even tell them what they are. But I took the time, took a lot of time, to go through each section, block, and lot, and it can be done on the Nassau County Assessor's website under property description or something like that. And you can go in and put in the section, block, and lot, and they give you a picture of the property. They give you a map to show you where it is, and they give you the address of the owner. So I went into all of these, and I took notes, identified all the properties, and I found, let me see my notes on each property, of where they were, and what they also give you the fair market value according to Nassau County assessors of each property. So I made a list of all these properties, and I handed it out at the Campbell Park meeting. The list includes the giant parking lot that's over there by Nagasaki. In that whole area, there is like a whole large giant parking lot that all the stores on Main Street, Fulton, and Franklin, in front, they all utilize that parking lot. It included Denton Green Park in front of the Village Hall. which is normally thought of as a cemetery, but it's not. It's a label there as a cemetery. It's not. Just a little portion in the corner is a cemetery, but that portion is owned by the church, and in the and the list of properties of private properties to try to be acquired, the church is on that list, as well as the cemetery, and it includes the extensive parking lot on Main Street that's adjacent to the bus terminal. That's quite a new parking lot. And it's right across from the Rivoli apartment building. It includes the land that the public library is on. It includes the village hall land, the police department, village court. It includes the parking lot next to village hall on Nicholas Court, which is has been just resurfaced. It includes the building department and the assessor's office, which has a building right in that same area. And all the parking lots on Jackson there, and even that little playground that's for the kids in the corner of Jackson and Washington. It includes two firehouses, the one on Clinton, and the big parking lot that's parking lot 16 behind there. It includes the firehouse on Jackson Street, which is next to the EOC building. And I might indicate that the EOC building is certainly a privately owned property there, and most likely, unless it's owned by Nassau County, I'm not sure, but whoever is owned it, whether it's private or public, that will also try to be taken in this process. It includes the commuter parking lots, the giant commuter parking lots right next to the railroad station. It includes the whole parking lot behind the Nassau County Courthouse. There's a giant parking lot there, and then if you go across Center Street, there's another very large parking lot that the courthouse uses. It includes that. It includes parking lot 10, which is used and has been for years by car dealerships to store their and they pay, you know, rent on that. Parking lot 9, which is right below that, between Maine and Washington, and that is used by the Town of Hempstead employee parking. Parking lot 8, which is like another block south of there between West Columbia and Bedell Streets. Parking lot 7, which is another block below that, between Jackson and West Columbia. And parking lot on the east side of Main Street between Fulton and Nichols Court, that is also a brand new parking lot. It's where the old Grants building used to be. Then for the CDA property, as I said, the parking lot that Nagasaki is on the corner of, that is part of it is owned by the village. The other part is owned by the CDA. So the CDA land there would be part of this sale. The large parking lot at the corner of Front Street and Washington. It extends up to Cooper Street, which is just south of Fulton. So that parking lot is used by the Town of Hempstead building that is across Front Street there, 350 Front Street. Then it includes that huge parking garage that's behind where the Motor Vehicle Bureau used to be, and it's also from Front Street. It's behind the St. George's Church and the cemetery there. And it includes, as I said before, the parking lot next to Denton Green, which is the old Grants building. And another parking lot that is on Fulton in the middle of the block between Franklin and Main Street that kind of goes north and south there. So I looked up the assessed value of all of these, the market value of all of these, the fair market value. And if you add it all up, it comes to over $53 million that of land to be sold to this developer. $53 million of village land and CDA land. And another really kind of horrifying part of this is that the money from the sale of this land is not going to the village. It's going to the Community Development Agency. That is right in the document. The money is to go to the CDA, and it will be under the control of the CDA, not under the control of the village, even though it's village land. Now, why they're doing that, I'm just guessing. I presume if they're going to threaten to use eminent domain, they need to have money to threaten with. And so perhaps they want to hold on to that. Perhaps they, since they're going to take the village hall and the library, there has to be a construction of a new village hall and a new library. Perhaps they want to use the money for that. Who knows what they want to do with that money? But in a time where the people are complaining about high taxes, et cetera, when they sell this land, instead of giving this money back to the taxpayers, they are holding it for whatever purpose. So that is another frightening part of this. But I think the most frightening part, there are two more most frightening parts. One is, what will this do to the whole Hempstead community? What are they going to try to build? Who is going to be there? Who is going to live there? Who is going to have businesses there? And what is the purpose of this whole redevelopment? That's one crucial part that you need to analyze. The other part is the level of dishonesty that has been undertaken, that the village board, the mayor, the CDA people, the commissioner, the developers themselves have not told this to the community. In fact, they have denied at the public hearing. They might have not have specifically made a denial at the public hearing, but they never told the people at the public hearing that this is what the public hearing was about. It was about the sale of the land. In order, the law states that in order for the village to sell land to a developer in an urban renewal area, they must hold a public hearing. And that was why they held that public hearing. It wasn't about jobs, and it wasn't about anything else. It was specifically about the sale of the village and CDA land. And this is a contract, this is a binding contract for the sale of that land. That contract has been signed with all this deception. They first of all signed it before they even put in there, and I believe the reason that they didn't put the section blocks and lot right in there in the beginning, because the public would have had access to it before the public hearing. And can you imagine what that public hearing would have been like if those section blocks and lots had been put in there where they should have been? So that was total deception. That public hearing must be declared invalid. And therefore, this document must be declared invalid. That's the only way that this thing can be stopped. Now, at the Campbell Park meeting, when I brought this information out, Don Ryan, trustee, states, oh, we're not going to sell all that land. You already sold it. It's in the document. This is a contract for the sale of the land. The developer says, we're not going to buy all that land. So they continue the lie. And it is so disconcerting to say, what in the world is going on? If this project is so wonderful, why are you hiding it from the community? If this project is so wonderful, why haven't you given us a site plan? See, Edwards has asked for a site plan from the very beginning when he saw this. He read the document. And he came to the next village board meeting and said, well, where is the site plan? What do you plan to build here? Victoria Hill came, she read the document to the meeting after the public hearing and said, you signed a blank check. How could you do that? And they have just allowed this to go on, not telling the people, keeping everybody in the dark. We don't know what they plan to build here. Now, we do know one thing that they plan to do, because it's in Appendix C of the Comprehensive Master Plan. It's been there since 2008. They have had this, a rendition of this, in the public library, in the meeting room. I've seen it there. They've had it in their own CDA office, a three-dimensional rendition of Appendix A. What is Appendix A? This is a 320-story condominium, luxury condominium building to be built on the premises where 100 Main Street is right now. That's the building owned by 100 black men. That's the building that has the McDonald's on the corner. It's right across from the courthouse. This is what the Community Development Agency wants to build on top. Well, of course, they will demolish 100 Main Street. They want to build an extraordinary Lincoln Center type performing arts center. Is that for the people of Hempstead, or is that for the people of Nassau County? I say it's the people of Nassau County. People of Hempstead are not going to be able, I mean, there probably are some people that could afford to go there, but it's clearly not for the majority of the people of Hempstead. It is an expensive building. It will have a high-tech library in it. Who is going to pay all the people that are going to staff this library? They're going to build a 4 or 5-story village hall in the middle of all this. Who is going to staff it? Who's going to heat it? Who's going to pay for it? Taxes are going to go up. So this has been on the internet since 2008. And not only that, a whole lawsuit was brought against the CDA and against the mayor by 100 black men, because they claim, 100 black men claim that the mayor and the CDA subverted their efforts to properly rent out the top story of their building when they had a contract with BOCES, and that they claim that the mayor intervened and got BOCES to pull out even after the contract was signed. And the whole idea was because they wanted 100 black men to go along with this luxury condo building and wanted the 100 black men to sell their building to the CDA. And they did everything they could to try to force that sale. The 100 black men stated in their lawsuit that they were offered up to $750,000 for the sale of 100 Main Street so that they could build this luxury building here. 100 black men told me that they wanted to build housing for the handicapped and workplace housing on top of their building. They could add several stories. But this is a 12-story building. And not only is it a 12-story building, it has all the way over here to the right, it has parking, in-house parking, for 550 vehicles. This is a luxury thing. This is what this developer and the CDA and the village are talking about in terms of bringing people into this community. Now, I have stated that the purpose of the plan is to force the black community, the minority people, out of Hempstead. I believe that that's the intent and purpose, though they will never admit that. But if you look at the plan, if you look at the fact that they are planning to build over 3,000, and when you include this, this giant building, and if you include 303 Main Street, you're now talking about 4,000 units of housing in this small part of the downtown village. You're talking about 4,000 housing, you're talking about maybe 8,000 people, and you're talking about close to, 7,000 or 8,000 cars. In fact, they're going to build parking garages because, see, they're buying all the parking lots. And so where are the people going to park? There's not going to be any more ground parking lots, maybe one or two if they, make it. They're going to try. Those 250 people who got their $10 jobs, they'll be building buildings that they will not be able to live in, and they won't even be able to live in their current place if they're living in apartments in Hempstead. Those buildings are already in the process of being converted. I know people at 600 Fulton who have indicated that they are bringing in people. This is how the landlords do it. This is what was done in Harlem also, is they know they have targeted certain areas. They will purposely bring in people into those buildings that will be disruptive and be involved in drugs and other type of activity that causes the ordinary people who have lived there for so many years to be upset and concerned, and they will start to move out. And then that will leave more apartments for other disruptive people to be moved in. This is the process they've been using, and they will use this. It's being done, it was done in Harlem, it's being done in all parts of Brooklyn, it's being done across the country. This is the meaning of justification. And as much as the mayor continues to say that this is not a process of gentrification, it most surely is. Not only is it a process of gentrification in those terms, it gets even more specific. Because in the document where they called for the submitted the proposal to get money for the sewers in the community. And I say, incidentally, that money for the sewers was to the benefit of the developer, not the village. Because in the documents that I have read, it indicates that the developer is responsible for the infrastructure. So the developer gets the village to apply for the funding, which is going to help the developer. And in that document, it was very revealing. Okay, so in this document, that was what we'll call the document requesting funds for the sewers that was submitted to the Long Island Council. It speaks about the foreign ownership element that's part of this project, and it states, both JFK and LaGuardia airports are within 17-mile drive, allowing easy access for international business travel as well as the export-import of goods and services. The international base of current and future Village of Hempstead residents will continue to attract investment in companies, real estate, and goods and services. Currently, more than 30% of all businesses in the village are owned by individuals of foreign origin. The international bilingual culture of the Village of Hempstead represents a significant attraction for foreign direct investment. This is only one of several factors representing significant potential for foreign direct investment. And then they go on to how they want to get Chinese investment. And then I heard someone told me, give me information. I haven't verified it yet, but they're even talking about having investment from Dubai, which basically is a country that has made its money on slave labor. Basically. So that's the foreign investment element in this thing. There's also the college town element, where Hofstra University is very interested in this whole downtown because they see it as a way of their expansion as Columbia University has expanded into Harlem, and how Nassau County is involved in this because it was Nassau County that determined, without consulting the people of Hempstead, that Hempstead was to become a college town, and this was announced at Hofstra University a number of years ago. So that is, in a nutshell, those two items. We can go into more detail about that at another time, but I appreciate your attention, and hope that you will join those of us in the Committee to Save Hempstead to stand up and demand that this contract be declared null and void, and that we relook at what is happening. Thank you.